And I think it's this magical, what we call the magical side of writing, that makes it feel really, really daunting and something that we cannot control.
Pat, at what point does empathy have to be present in the story? So if we have a character that's unlikable, but eventually we determine, okay, we understand why they're doing what they're doing, is there a certain point where the empathy meter has to kick in for the audience?
Yeah, I actually think the empathy meter has to kick in on page one. Like, that connection needs to be established immediately in the story. And if it's not, we're going to struggle to connect to that person and follow them, especially if they're kind of an anti-hero main character. So for example, in The Talented Mr. Ripley, where Tom Ripley is an anti-hero, the filmmaker and the writer, I think it's Anthony Minghella, works really hard on page one to establish why he wants what he wants. He wants to be seen by people in power. He wants to play music, and he's basically living in poverty. And we see him in this environment, and we see him yearning to be part of this glittery, rich crowd. And so because we are so connected to him around that, because all of us have been wanting to be part of something that maybe we can never be part of, right? We can all relate to that. And so later, when he starts doing terrible things to stay part of that group, that glittery crowd, we totally understand why he's doing it. And it's so deeply embedded in our understanding of the character that he can pretty much do anything and we will still follow him through this story. So no matter what kind of movie you're writing, even if it's an anti-hero type of movie, you have to establish that connection or that understanding pretty quickly in the story.
What is the mystery that sometimes makes writing seem so daunting?
If only I knew what the mystery was. There's so many mysteries. Okay, so the way I look at writing is like, there's the craft, right? There's the things that you can learn, you know, like how to create a great character, like what's three-act structure, how to write a great scene, you know, what's good dialogue, how to tell a visual story, all that kind of stuff. You can kind of learn that stuff, right? And you can sort of absorb it and practice it and get better at it. But the second half of writing is this weird alchemy. And I love that you described it as magical, because it is magic. It feels like magic sometimes. And sometimes you can't control that magical side. Like this other side that's like, I made an outline and I have my act breaks and here's the midpoint. Like that you can control on the page. But the part of writing that uses the right side of your brain, that is really holistic and intuitive and connecting, it feels like magic. Because at times, at least when I'm writing, I feel like I'm literally just taking dictation from someone, that I'm just typing, these people are talking to me, and I'm writing down what they say. And there are other times where I'm writing scenes where it's like, enter scene, she wants this, she does this to get it, there is, so it's very kind of like practical, you know? And I think it's this magical, what we call the magical side of writing, that makes it feel really, really daunting and something that we cannot control. And that, you know, we want to be able to go, every time I sit down to write, it's magical, you know, and it's not. And the one thing that I've discovered about the magical side of writing is that it won't happen unless you're sitting in the chair. You know, and it's not there the whole time, you know, and it does seem daunting because you can't control it. But if you put in the work, if you sit in the chair, if you show up every day and create that time, you know, for me, like if I work at the same time every day, that becomes magic, because I have created a ritual where I sit down, I turn on my computer, I have my coffee. You know, I post a writing quote every morning. So I look and I find a writing quote that applies to me. What am I struggling with today? And then I find that quote and then I post it. And then I sit down and I start to write. And because I've created these routines around my writing, the magic is attracted to it. And so it doesn't always go well. I mean, you know, I have days where I write nothing or I write one page and it's really bad and I know it's bad. But I found that this idea that it's daunting can actually take on its own dark power. You know, that there's this thing out there and it's magic and I don't have access to it because writing for me is hard. It's hard for everyone. You know, it's hard. How many drafts have you written of this thing? You still have to try to find that thing that once it clicks, it's like, oh, I found it, you know. But in order to attach to that magic, you have to actually be sitting in your chair and just showing up every single day. I love that you mentioned Richard Walter earlier in our comments, because he was my screenwriting teacher. But he used to say this thing in class, which I thought was really great, which is there's no such thing as writer's block. That is something that we actually create in our minds as a way of avoiding facing things in our writing or in our script. If we're writing about something that's really emotionally close to us, you know, it's like suddenly writing becomes really hard and now I'm worried about the person I'm writing about and they're going to read the script and I need to change the character. And, you know, I think as writers, we have to stop thinking about it as writer's block, because we create the block. We create the block because of other things that are going on. And so, you know, all we have to do and all we really can do is show up in the chair and write. And again, this is just my experience. I'm sure other writers have had different experiences. The magic does not come very often at all. But when it comes, it's like amazing. And suddenly things start to make sense. And you didn't understand what the script was about. And why is this character doing this thing? Suddenly you go, oh my God, this is why she's doing it. And this is what she would do next, because she wants, you know. And so That connective side of your brain is the magic, I think. And in order to let it do its job, you just have to drag your left side of your brain that made the outline into the chair and work diligently and just wait for it to come, you know?
So thunder's not going to crash outside your window while you're, I mean, not every time, once, okay.
I actually find thunder crashes inside me. Like, my anxiety is its own daunting thing to deal with around writing, you know. And if I could tame my anxiety and really get it under control, I feel like the dauntingness of writing would be far lessened for me, you know. And I don't know, I'm sure other writers struggle with anxiety as well, but it's super, it can take over your brain. And then you start thinking about other things and stuff. And so, again, creating those rituals where you sit down at your desk and you have your cup of coffee or your tea or whatever, and you have little colored pencils, like, that you really make it almost religious, you know? Because what happens is when you create those patterns, the minute you sit down, your brain starts to go into that mode of, like, now it's writing time. Now I'm gonna write, you know? Yeah, I don't think you can depend on inspiration or like a thunderstorm to inspire you or whatever. You just have to be diligent and show up and do the work.
You know, it's great, because I have this quote here that we were saving for the end, but it's funny that I chose this. I saw on your blog that you love Joan Didion.
Yeah.
And that you were watching a documentary. I think she's had at least one or two.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
And so she says here, do not whine, do not complain, work harder, spend more time alone. And this is from her 2011 memoir, Blue Nights.
Yes.
So, yeah, I don't know. That's kind of fitting.
Yes,
it sounds like that, that's weird that I chose
that's
it.
That's the truth. Mm-hmm. That is the truth in that one sentence. You know, as writers and especially as women, you know, like, it's hard to find time alone. And it's hard to prioritize your writing. You know, especially if you're still working in a regular job and you're trying to sort of you're writing, but you have kids or a family or whatever, you know, it's very hard to prioritize that alone time. But if you don't do it, you won't get the work done, you know? And so, I love what she says about work hard, carve that space out in your life to be alone, because in order to get your pages done, you really do have to be alone. and you do, you know, whether you like music playing or whatever environment you like to write in, you have to act like it's really important and you have to prioritize it. Because if you don't, it'll be the first thing to get shoved away. You know, when my kids, I mean, they're young adults now, I have two boys, but when they were babies, I used to just set my coffee pot to like 4 a.m. I would set my alarm. I would get up at 4 a.m. It was completely quiet. Everybody was asleep. I would go into the kitchen. I would get my cup of coffee and I would just go into the den and I would write until 6. And then everyone started screaming and crying and needing me. And then I could start my day and I could do meetings or whatever I had to do. But I had carved out that time in the darkness by myself with a single lamp on with my computer to get my work done. Now, I was wiped out by 4 p.m. Like I was like a zombie walking through my life. But I kind of arranged my day so that I didn't really need to do anything that required a lot of thought at the end of the day, you know? So it worked out for me. But at first it was really hard to make that commitment and go, I'm getting up at 4 in the morning, because it was just like, oh, these kids are killing me. Oh my God. You know, it's just, motherhood was like a big thing. And I just found when I had those 2 hours in the morning, got my work done, I was so much happier the rest of the day. I interacted with my children in a positive way. And most importantly, I got my pages done, you know? And so how do you carve out that alone time? Do you need to actually get out of your house? You know, sometimes your house is so busy that there's no way to work there. So is there a coffee shop that you love where you can go and just sit there with your latte and, you know, stay there for an hour and a half? One thing that I've read about, which is really interesting and hopefully helpful for the people who are your viewers, is that they've done studies where people who write at the same time every day and create this pattern, this habit, are much more productive and tend to finish their projects. Maya Angelou used to, she couldn't work in her house. So she would she had a room reserved at a hotel, and like she would show up there at 9 a.m. in her little hotel room. She would write until noon, get her pages done. And then in the afternoon, she'd go to lunch, do whatever she, you know, if she had meetings or whatever she needed to do, or read, you know, whatever she needed to do in the afternoons she could do. But she went to her office, like in this hotel room, and created that ritual for herself away from her family so that she could get her work done.